Moving on. Should we talk about let's talk about Lucy's dreaming. Jay, you want to take
it? Sorry, what?
Lucy dreaming, not Lucy's. Yeah,
there we
Lucy
go.
Dreaming.
Did anyone else read it?
I read it.
I did read it too.
I didn't. Okay. I didn't know it wasn't for kids, so I didn't read it.
It's for kids.
Oh.
Well, maybe issue 5 is more all ages.
Oh, I didn't. I only read the first issue. What issue were we supposed to read?
We were supposed to read 1 through 5.
Oh no, that I did not do. I'm sorry.
Why not?
I didn't know we were supposed to do 1 through 5. What? At what point did we say that? I don't remember.
He said it on the conference call at the end of the show last week.
I said then, to read Lucy Dreaming.
Yeah.
That means you're supposed to read the whole thing.
They're on 5, so you read the whole thing.
No, see, I did not realize that that was what... I thought we were talking about, like, number 1, and that's what I read.
Damn it, Lawrence.
I don't know what to tell you. Mo read 1 through 5 because he hates Disney.
Actually, I'm waiting for Disney to buy up this property. And give you a homogenized version of it like they did The Little Mermaid and Beauty and the Beast.
She was a bitch.
Ooh. Who, Lucy?
Who? Ariel.
Yeah, but look, we're not talking about that. Talk about Lucy Dreaming. Come on, man. We got a half hour of showtime left. Get to it.
All right. So Lucy Dreaming is a Boom Studios comic written by Max Bemis, the lead singer for Say Anything. And it's art by Michael Dialysis. Right.
Oh, Dialinas. Sorry.
So it's basically about this girl who has a really vivid dream and wakes up with yellow eyes and finds out that she has the ability to enter the storyscape, which is where stories are real and kind of like there are no ideas, just it's people receiving subliminal info from stories that are actually happening. And so she goes in and she finds out one of her friends can also go, but his intentions aren't really good. And he ends up trying to destroy everything, which ends up having real world consequences and spilling out into all realities. And so she has to try and stop him. So...
Is that the Darth Vader guy?
Yeah.
Okay. So, yeah. The shit's amazing.
It is really good. Like, this is one of those books that's very character-focused, and Lucy is a great character. Like, she's a teenage girl who's kind of got an attitude, but she knows, like, she's self-aware.
Right.
Which makes her interesting. And, you know, she knows she's pretentious. She knows that she should be happy, but she chooses to, like, not do that and just get involved, like, with their books instead of socializing. And, her parents are, like, mad scientists who created a gateway into the dreamscape, into the storyscape. And she got the ability because they were pregnant with her when they created it. And the parents are interesting. Even the bad guy is, like, pretty interesting, even though he's kind of one note. And I guess one of the places where the book does shine is when she is dreaming, like, the different characters she becomes. And you get these small glimpses of these alternate worlds. And the comedy is really on point with this book. I think they, like...
Oh, go ahead. Finish your thought. Sorry.
Oh, yeah. Like, the comedy works.
So this book is like Sucker Punch?
Yes, in a way. Like, that's where I really, like... I didn't know what Lucy Dreaming was about when Joe mentioned it last week. I picked up the first issue today, and I read it. And I did want to read the rest, but the way the first one ended, it's like... The experience of reading the first issue... left me like, oh no, I want to feel the joy of waiting a month to read the next one. Because the cliffhanger, like, for the first, like, 4 or 5 pages are just her dealing with mundane life. And that resonated with me a lot, because that's how I live my life. Yeah. You know, and then she goes into the storyscape, and it's a cool story that resonates with me because I like Star Wars, and it does its thing. And but then her doing the way that issue ended, with even with the revelation that Darth Vader guy is a guy she knows, I was like, wow. It went from, I could have just, the first 4 or 5 pages were just her internal monologue,
right,
dealing with her life. And I was
you were talking about that guy? No, he's not her friend, but he is
important. He's another dreamer guy?
Yeah, he's actually really important later on.
I mean, when you say a Darth Vader guy, like that, there's 2 Darth Vader guys?
Well, technically, no. He's more like becomes like an apocalypse guy.
The friend.
But black. Yeah.
Apocalypse is black.
That is true. Well, he's Egyptian, so it depends on who you ask.
Well, ancient Egyptian's
in
black.
In color, he's blue, right?
Well, he's gray with blue highlights.
Right. Well, imagine instead of gray with blue highlights,
kind of like Burr.
Highlights.
Okay. So yeah, the Darth Vader guy. So the way the first issue went, like, it switched into the storyscape, and then it was all storyscape with just a little bit of her waking up, and that was like, I'm like, wow. I've never really liked anything best Max Bemis has ever done, including his music. So, well, mainly his music, but so this one I was surprised. Like, I knew it was him going in, but I'm like, you know what, I'm gonna check this out.
Didn't he do Umbrella Academy?
No.
Oh, what did he do?
He did Whisperbirds.
Huh?
He did Moon Knight.
And Moon Knight, but nobody read that Moon Knight.
No, he did Moon Knight and what else?
And Whispers.
I thought he did another book that was like a book that we...
Oh, you're talking about Armory Wars.
Armory Wars? I don't think so, but maybe.
That's the guy from Coheed and Cambria.
Right, that's a different band.
Yeah.
No, I do understand that.
Depending on who you ask, they might be the same band.
But... Honestly, I think they're a lot better.
Who, Coheed?
But I do kind of really like the guy's singing voice.
Yeah, but that's all it is. Like, there's no, like, real band in it. Like, yeah. Anyway, we're not going to discuss his production technique. You know, right. he puts the volume on his voice and lowers the percussion. Like, who does that in a rock band? Like, anyway. Yeah. I'm not trying to be his producer or anything. But anyway, yeah. The first issue had, a really good flow and a good dynamic. And even, like, touching on the Star Wars stuff, like, her being the Princess Leia person and dealing with her thing, like, was really cool. And yeah, I don't know. I really want to read the rest. Unlike, you know, any of Max Bemis's other stuff.
And you said you read the first one, Lawrence?
Yes.
What did you think?
I did like it. I don't think I liked it as much as the two of you, but it's not bad. It just didn't, like, it didn't, I guess, resonate with me quite in the same way that it did for the two of you. The story was good. I liked the idea of the dreamscape or the storyscape. I'm sorry. Even though it's not like it's a new idea, but I like how it's executed here, but it wasn't executed in such a way where I'm just was like blown away. I liked the art. I thought the art was pretty good and it was interesting. You know, all in all, like, I enjoyed my read. I would read the second issue, but it would be one of those things where from my perspective, I would kind of be like, the first issue was definitely good enough for me to read the second, but I'd be looking for the second one to, like, kind of step it up and almost, like, wow me a little bit for me to, like, continue with the series. But I do think, like, the things that the two of you mentioned are definitely there. Like, I feel like it was interesting watching the story unfold. I think all of the characters are interesting. It's just, like, it's really just a matter of degree, you know? It's like how interesting they are. And it's not like you know, by no means are any of the characters uninteresting. It was just a matter of, like, well, you know, how into it was I? And it just turns out, like, I was like, you know, I'm kind of into it. I'm pretty into it, but it's not a thing where I'm like, I definitely have to read issue two. Like, I will read issue two, and if issue two can go ahead and basically, like, touch me deeper, then I'll read issue three. I think realistically, everything you said all registers to me. Like, the humor, the characters, you know, like, it's all good stuff. So it's just a matter of, and again, it might also be a thing too, where it's kind of almost like, you know, you only have so much time to read a certain amount of books, and maybe it's like, this is a book for me that's like, okay, it's right on the cutoff line. So I'm like, well, issue two make it so that it's like, okay, and I need to make sure I keep up with this and get rid of something else that might be, like, not quite there for me to read, you know? So yeah, that's where I'm at.
I give issue one 5 life wins out of 5.
Wow. There you go. Yeah, for me, I would give issue, like, the first issue, it'd be like 3.5 out of 5.
And I give the series overall a 4 out of 5. There's, like, one weird message that comes across that is a little weird, but everything else is really good.
But that's not in issue one, right?
No. I think it comes in, like, they start talking about it in issue 4.
What I really liked about the art in issue one, there was, like, shadows and textures and stuff where, like, you know, you see the foreground, the people talking in frame, but then you see the wall behind them. And it's like most comics don't take that into consideration. You know what I mean?
That is true.
So I was like, especially when they're talking at breakfast, you know?
Yeah.
In the first few pages, I was like, wow, like they put, you know, the character design is what it is. Like it's kind of cartoonist.
But it's good. It's stylized.
It's stylized and good. But then they actually like bothered to like have the right proportions of the counter space and the cabinets and all this. So it's like, man, this it proved to me that the artist is actually not only good technically, but also artistically, and he's versatile.
Right.
So it's like I want to see more of what he can do, maybe even on a Power Rangers white cover.
He's so crazy, dude.
And that's what pushed it over to the 5 too. Like when you talk about the storyscape not being an entirely original idea, like there's a whole, dare I say, a cult of people that believe that a lot of the movies and stuff we see are what people remember from past lives, you know?
Right.
So you know, it's like the reincarnation isn't really like reincarnating here, but you go into like Narnia or some shit, you know?
Right.
So in fact, if I get to see that in here, it would really like maybe push it into a 6 out of 5 kind of on a meta level, you know what I mean?
You want a Narnia experience inside?
Well, no, it's just kind of like that whole concept like being utilized as driving the story more than just something passed off as original, you know?
Oh, where you're like it kind of shows that people have said that they like, you know, people have tapped into that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I hear you. Yeah.
So, Oz, what do you give it out of 5?
No, I didn't read it. I